Thanks, Xavier. Thank you all for being here with us today. So today I'm going to be talking about systemic therapies for neuroendocrine tumors. So systemic therapy, what that means are treatments, medical treatments that treat the whole body. And I'm going to be delving just a little bit into the clinical trial data, and there's a lot of information, so these slides will be available for your reference after the conference. So let's see how it advances. So here's my disclosures. So when we think about neuroendocrine tumors, this is really a broad umbrella term for very heterogeneous groups of tumors. We describe them by differentiation, by grading, by their anatomic location, and by whether they're functional or non-functional. And as Thor has mentioned, there's the WHO classification scheme for neuroendocrine tumors based on the tumor grade and differentiation. So in the interest of time today, we're going to focus mainly on systemic therapies for grade 1 and grade 2 well-differentiated neuroendocrine tumors. So the first category of systemic therapies that we're going to talk about are the somatostatin analogs. So these are treatments that mimic somatostatin, which is a hormone that your body produces, and they bind to receptors on the tumor cells called somatostatin receptors. And not only are they beneficial in controlling some of the hormonal symptoms of neuroendocrine tumors, they are also have been shown to stop tumor growth. So as you can see in this figure, when the drug binds to the receptor, an intricate and complex cascade of reactions happen within the tumor cells that ultimately lead to stopping the tumor growth, lead to cell death, and inhibits the tumor from growing and invading. So the basis for our somatostatin analogs is based on several large phase 3 clinical trials. For octreotide LAR, the other name is sandostatin. This was approved based on the PROMID clinical trial. And in this study, patients with grade 1 midgut neuroendocrine tumors were randomized to receive octreotide LAR every 4 weeks by intramuscular injection versus placebo. So in order to make sense of the clinical trial data, I just wanted to go over a little bit about the lingo we use in clinical trial. So this figure here is what's called a Kaplan-Meier survival curve. And basically, on the y-axis, you see the number of patients whose tumors remain stable. And on the x-axis, you see time as the treatment progresses. And so on the top line here, you see the patients who were treated with octreotide LAR, whereas on the bottom green line, you see the patients who were treated with placebo. Progression-free survival means the amount of time that the tumor remains stable. And as you can see from this clinical trial, the progression-free survival from the placebo group was about 6 months, whereas that of the treatment group was about 14 months. So that more than doubled the progression-free survival of these neuroendocrine tumor patients. Response rate means, in clinical trial lingo, means the, out of 100 people, how many patients will have their tumor shrink 30% or more in diameter. So as you can see, this is a drug that mainly keeps the tumor stable rather than shrink it significantly, and only 2% of the patients experience a tumor shrinkage of greater than 30% in diameter. Another somatostatin analog that we use commonly is called lanreotide, so the commercial name is called Somatulin. And this drug was approved for treatment based on a phase 3 CLARINET study. So the patient population is slightly different. So they included all gastrointestinal and pancreatic neuroendocrine tumors with a Ki-67 of less than 10%. And they required that patients had stable disease for 3 to 6 months prior to enrollment in the trial. In this trial, the patients were randomized to getting lanreotide injections every 4 weeks. This is a subcutaneous injection versus placebo. And again, as you can see, the treatment with lanreotide significantly improved the progression-free survival compared to the placebo group. The response rate, again, was low, meaning this is a drug that mainly keeps the tumor stable rather than shrink it significantly. The next category of systemic treatments that we're going to talk about is called targeted therapy. So these are drugs that target specific pathways that tumor cells use to grow and spread. And most of these are oral pills that you take daily. So the first drug that we're going to talk about is called sunitinib or Sutent. So this is a drug that inhibits multiple receptors on the cell. Some of them include PDGFR, KIT, FLT3, and then something called the vascular endothelial growth factor. So it's a way that tumors make new blood vessels. And this is a pill that you take once a day, and some of the common side effects include feeling tired, nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, something called hand-foot syndrome, which is redness and pain and peeling in your hand and feet. And this drug can also cause high blood pressure. So sunitinib was approved for treatment for pancreatic neuroendocrine tumors based on this phase 3 clinical trial. So these were patients who were previously treated with the somatostatin analog, such as octreotide or lanreotide, and that their tumors had progressed on those treatments. So in this study, patients were randomized to receive sunitinib versus placebo. And as you can see, treatment with sunitinib more than doubled the progression-free survival of these patients. The response rate was 9%, meaning this, again, is a treatment that keeps the tumor stable rather than causing significant tumor shrinkage. Another drug that is approved for the treatment of neuroendocrine tumors is called everolimus or Afinitor. And this works a little bit differently than the sunitinib by targeting a different pathway called mTOR, which stands for mammalian target of rapamycin. And mTOR is a pathway that is crucial to the pathogenesis of neuroendocrine tumors. It's been shown to be involved in tumor growth and spread, and also how it makes new blood vessels, how it repairs DNA damages, etc. The common side effects of everolimus include feeling tired, mouth sores, diarrhea, rash, and high blood sugars. So everolimus was approved for the treatment in pancreatic neuroendocrine tumors based on the phase 3 RADIANT-3 study. So in this study, patients with grade 1 or grade 2 pancreatic neuroendocrine tumors were randomized to receive everolimus versus placebo. And this, again, is second-line treatment, meaning patients have had prior medical therapy before with an SSA. And as you can see in the results of the study, treatment with everolimus doubled the progression-free survival versus treatment with placebo. The response rate, again, is in the single digits, so this is a drug that kind of stops the tumor growth rather than cause significant shrinkage. And in this trial, they followed the patients long enough that we can see, you know, if there's a significant benefit in terms of overall survival. So as you can see, patients who were treated with everolimus had an overall survival of 44 months versus those on the placebo group who had an overall survival of 37 months. Of note, this study allowed for what's called crossover, meaning patients who were getting placebo, whose cancers progressed, were then able to cross over to the everolimus arm and get the actual study treatment. And in general, for studies that allow for crossover, that kind of dilutes the overall survival benefit. So the true survival benefit may actually be greater. What about using this drug, everolimus, for other neuroendocrine tumors? So There is data from the phase 3 Radiant 4 study for using everolimus in other gastrointestinal neuroendocrine tumors and also in lung neuroendocrine tumors. So in this study, patients with grade 1 or grade 2 other gastrointestinal lung neuroendocrine tumors were randomized to receive everolimus versus placebo. And this again is second line treatment. And similar to the other studies, this treatment more than doubled the progression-free survival of these patients. So to summarize all of the currently FDA-approved treatments, targeted treatments for neuroendocrine tumors. So for pancreatic neuroendocrine tumors, we have everolimus and sunitinib. And for other gastrointestinal and lung neuroendocrine tumors, we have everolimus. And as you can see, treatment with these targeted therapies more than doubled the progression-free survival versus placebo, reducing the risk of tumor progression by 50 to 60%. And in general, as a class, these are drugs that tend to keep the tumor stable rather than cause significant shrinkage. So what's next in the realm of targeted therapy? So there's a new targeted therapy agent that is currently being investigated in the setting of a clinical trial. So this is a drug called cabozantinib or Cabometyx. And it targets some of the same similar receptors as sunitinib and everolimus, but also targets a few other ones that the previous treatments did not target. So some of them include a receptor called AXL or AXL, and the other one is a receptor called MET. And it does this to, in the hopes of inhibiting tumor growth and inhibiting its ability to make new blood vessels, and also to modulate what's called the immune microenvironment of the tumor cells to make your immune system work better at attacking the tumor cells. So cabozantinib right now is being studied in a phase 3 clinical trial called the CABINET study, and this is a multi-institutional collaborative group study run by the Alliance for Clinical Trials in Oncology. In this study, patients with advanced well-differentiated or moderately differentiated neuroendocrine tumors who have previously received everolimus are randomized in a 2-to-1 fashion to get cabozantinib versus placebo. And so this is an exciting new treatment strategy, and this study is actually open in multiple centers around the country, including here at UChicago Medicine. Lastly, I just wanted to talk a little bit about cytotoxic chemotherapy. So when you hear the word chemotherapy, this is what we refer to. So these are, in general, treatments that go after tumor cells that are actively growing. They cause cell death in many different ways, such as causing DNA damages or messing with the way that the tumors divide. And there's been a long history of traditional chemotherapy in the treatment of neuroendocrine tumors, and the regimens have really evolved over time. And the most current regimen that we use in neuroendocrine tumors is a combination of capecitabine and temozolomide, otherwise known as CAP TEM. And these are both oral chemotherapy drugs. The way you take it is capecitabine is given twice a day from day 1 to day 14 every 28 days. So in other words, 2 weeks on and 2 weeks off. And then temozolomide is also a pill that you take during days 10 to 14 during that 28-day period. So in other words, you're only on temozolomide for 5 days out of the month. And so this is some recently presented data for capecitabine and temozolomide for the treatment of pancreatic neuroendocrine tumors. So this is the phase 2 ECOG study that randomized patients with pancreatic neuroendocrine tumor to receive capecitabine and temozolomide versus temozolomide alone. And these are the results for progression-free survival. As you can see, for patients who got temozolomide alone, progression-free survival was 14 months. For patients who got the combination, the progression-free survival was 22.7 months. What about overall survival? So this is very early, premature data, but it seems that there is a significant benefit in terms of improving overall survival as well with the combination treatment. What about tumor responses or response rates? So in this study, they showed that the combination of capecitabine and temozolomide had a response rate of 33%, meaning one in three patients who got CAP TEM will experience significant tumor shrinkage greater than 30%. So this is unlike other treatments that we talked about earlier. This treatment can actually shrink tumors, and we'll talk about why that's important in the context of other treatments such as surgery, et cetera. So to summarize the evolving landscape of systemic therapies, you know, we've talked about the role of somatostatin analogs, of targeted therapies, and of traditional chemotherapy in the treatment of neuroendocrine tumors. What we haven't talked about and will be discussed by other speakers later today include PRRT, which is peptide receptor radionuclide therapy, includes the role of surgical debulking that Drs. Koitken and Hao just talked a little bit about, include liver-directed therapy, which I believe there will be a session this afternoon, and then immunotherapy, which Dr. Koons will talk a little bit about. And what we're trying to show you is that because there are so many different treatment options, a multidisciplinary approach is really the key to managing neuroendocrine tumors, and that future clinical studies are needed to help us better understand how to sequence and combine all of these available treatment options. So we'll save questions for later and then move on to the next part of the talk.
Thank you very much, Anne.